Good morning, everybody. It was, I don't know if you all know that even on the way out, you are supposed to sign. Most of you, I think, are aware of that. But those of you who are not aware, please ensure that you sign on your attendance sheets on your way out. The program is being webcast live. So besides all of you on an early Sunday morning, we have a lot of other people watching. So we'll start with Dr. Rajul Parekh's talk for the day.
There are two questions we are going to deal with. How do I choose which investigation to order? And more importantly, I'm going to cover the second aspect, how to use the diagnostic test in day-to-day practice. There are lots of new machines in every field. Doesn't mean that whichever machines or whichever company makes a new machine, doesn't mean that it is perfect or better than the existing machines we have. We should not go by how the printout looks. We should not go by who is marketing or advertising the machine. There are lots of more important aspects to go after it, and that we are going to discuss today. How many are ophthalmology residents here? Good. So this is a question. A 54-year-old male patient comes for regular checkup. Pressures are 24, open angle, and 0.7 cup inferior rim thinning. Can we just do OCT for diagnosis of open angle glaucoma? Since you are the only one, you have privilege to answer my question. There is nobody else. Tell me, why? Why you require progression? I know by definition is progressive, chronic, progressive optic neuropathy. Will you wait for all glaucoma patients for it to progress before you diagnose glaucoma? You know, will not. So that your answer is partly wrong. The second, you said visual field. Why you required visual field? The definition again says that visual field changes with corresponding optic disc changes. So it doesn't say only visual field changes. Can you diagnose open angle glaucoma before you do visual field? You can.
Yes.
The question is that will you use only OCT for diagnosis or not? Your answer is right, that only OCT is not acceptable in most of the situation, but we can use OCT for the diagnosis, okay? And why, that we are going to discuss. Now, before that, there are certain criteria. Now, this is ideally a very long topic, and I'm not going to cover it, but when you publish or read anything about the investigations, the methodology of the article where they use the machine, like the sensitivity specificity of OCT or perimetry or in radiology CT scan or MRI or whatever, what are the methodology points they should have included? The first is independent blind comparison with the gold standard. So if I want to use OCT, I must use, what is the gold standard for glaucoma at this point in time? What? Automated perimetry is still gold standard. So I must use, what is the diagnostic accuracy as compared to automated perimetry? It should include the appropriate spectrum. So we should have a glaucoma suspect, early glaucoma, moderate glaucoma, severe glaucoma, all spectrum of glaucoma in the sample. And when I said glaucoma suspect, individual with different but commonly confusing disorders. In glaucoma, we have a disc suspect, large disc, which lots of time we think that it can be glaucoma, but they are not actually glaucoma. So all things which can we get confused for the disease. Third, the evaluation process has to be written very properly, that if I want to carry the study or you want to carry my study, you can easily do it. The precision observational variation has to be determined. Normal has to be defined sensibly. I cannot just write a normal 100 normals were there. On what basis I have defined normal? So in glaucoma, the pressure less than certain things, optic is absolutely normal, then I must write down what I feel by normal. When I want to write down normal, I have to write down very clearly what I mean by abnormal. So those things has to be very clearly defined. If it is done as a cluster test, then each test has to be described and done at an individual basis. As I said, that it has to be written down very clearly that somebody wants to do the study, can be carried out. And last, utility of the test has to be determined, that what, if the test is useful in a research setting, what implications we will have if we start using in a day-to-day practice. And that is what I am going to cover. These I have just given the few questions, because each questions we can elaborate and discuss. My talk I wanted to restrict to how to use the test in day-to-day practice. So these you can read from the textbook. If you have any questions, we can discuss at the end of the day. But what we will discuss now, at how to use the diagnostic test or whatever test we have performed in day-to-day practice. Now there are two issues. Basically everything is simple 2x2 table, and if you had privilege or luxury yesterday to discuss with Dr. JP, or if you discussed 2x2 table, I am not sure. Did he manage to do that 2x2 table? No. Then we will start with 2x2 table. But there are two. One, we will discuss about sensitivity and specificity of individual test. That is several limitations to use in day-to-day practice. The second option is likelihood ratio, because that we can incorporate all the tests we are doing in an appropriate manner for the diagnosis and management of the patient. So that we'll discuss two aspects. Both are, everything is basically 2x2 table, and 2x2 table basically here is, we have a patient who had a disease, a group, and people who did not have disease, normal. In group, certain people would have a positive test, certain percent people would have a negative test. In normals also, so most of the people would have normal test, but certain would be positive. So you divide into 2x2 table. Disease positive and test positive is true positive. Disease positive and test negative is false negative, because actually they have disease but the test is negative. And in disease normal population, we have majority would be here true negative, but some would have a false positive test and it would be here. So 2x2 is very clear. True positive, false negative, this forms a disease group. True negative, false positive forms the normal group. Now, what is sensitivity? True positive divided by, only true positive is only one value. True positive divided by true positive plus false negative. A divided by A plus C. Of course, prevalence of disease is A plus C divided by total population. So sensitivity is A divided by A plus C. What is specificity? True negative divided by true negative plus false positive. So D divided by B plus D. Now what do you mean by specificity? In a simple word. True negatives. Now, predictive value is a little different than sensitivity and specificity. Using the same 2x2 table, the sensitivity and specificity goes this way. The predictive value goes this way. So, predictive value is ability of the test to detect true positives. That how many of the disease, of actual disease, how many percent of the people were diagnosed by the test. So that is A divided by A plus C, A plus B. True positive divided by true positive plus false positive. And the negative predictive value is ability of the taste to determine actual normals. So D divided by C plus D. Basically, PPV, positive predictive value, means that if the person have a positive taste, what are the chances that he is actually having disease? And if the test is negative, what are the chances that patient is actually normal, that is negative predictive value. This four terminology is very clear. Any doubt? Good. So, as we said, it goes horizontal, the sensitivity specificity goes vertical. Now this is a table. This is population, this is normal population. What is the prevalence of disease? What is the disease population? 90 plus 10. This is disease population 100. Total population 200. So what is the prevalence of disease? 100 divided by 200. So 50%. What is the sensitivity? 90%. Specificity 80 divided by 100. 80%. Clear? Positive predictive value is 90 divided by 110, 81.8%. Negative predictive value 80 divided by 90, 88.9%. What is sensitivity? 90 divided by 10, 90%. 720 divided by 900, again 80%. So the first table and second table, sensitivity and specificity is same. What is changed now here is prevalence of disease. What is prevalence? 100 divided by 1000. So 10%. What is positive predictive value here? 90 divided by 270, nearly 33%. Negative predictive value 720 divided by 730, 98.6%. What is the inference from here? Anybody? The sensitivity and specificity of taste remains same. What has changed? The prevalence of disease has changed drastically from 50% to 10%. What happened to predictive value of the taste? Positive predictive value dropped from 82% to 33%. Negative predictive value increased from 89% to 98.6%. Let's give one more example. What is the sensitive specificity? Please do not, this is not a sabji market. People who are not interested, I have no problem, they can go out and eat tea, coffee. Please do not speak inside. What is sensitivity here? 9 divided by 10, 90%. Specificity 720, 792, again is same, 80%. What is prevalence of disease here? 10 divided by 1000 is 1%. What happened to predictive value? Dropped to 4%. And negative predictive value increased to 99.8%. So with the same taste, same sensitivity and specificity, depending upon the prevalence, your predictive value changes, right? The machine is the same. The population also is the same. But as your disease prevalence decreases, the predictive value, because we are more interested in predictive value, that if I do the test, I do not know whether patient has glaucoma or not glaucoma. I do not know whether patient has certain disease X, Y, Z before I do the test. So if the test is positive, what are the chances that patient actually has the disease? So if I do the test randomly in all the general population, because most of the disease would have a very low prevalence, in a general population, the chances of finding actual disease is very low. If we randomly do the test in all the population, if all the patient who comes in my clinic or in your clinic, if we do OCT, OCT may have a 80%, 90% sensitivity, 90% specificity. But because prevalence of glaucoma is very low, the positive predictive value would be very low. You got the point? The sensitive specificity per se is not important, it's important. But doing randomly is useless. So, as the prevalence of disease increases, the positive predictive value of test increases. Now, the issue is how can you increase the prevalence of disease? If you want to increase the predictive value, positive predictive value, basically what you have to do from this graph is very clear. As the prevalence increases, predictive value increases dramatically. So if you want to utilize the test, then you have to increase the prevalence of disease. Now you can't inflict the disease, but you can choose the population where chances of having disease is high. So if I want to do a glaucoma screening, I am not talking about that screening as a routine thing. But even in clinical practice, if I want to select a high risk group for the glaucoma, the prevalence of disease would be high. And if I do the test, then chances of that positive predictive value definitely will increase because prevalence will increase. So if we do the OCT in a population where age is more than 40, the risk of glaucoma increases. If you have another family history of glaucoma, intraocular pressure more than 21, or if you have done an examination, then that likelihood ratio will come as a second part, because then we are shifting to using all the available information for diagnosis. But if you restrict to a high risk group, then the positive predictive test would be very high. So doing randomly any test, even with 90% sensitivity specificity, will not make any sense, because disease prevalence is always low. The glaucoma prevalence is 3%. Diabetic retinopathy is 3 and 4% is still low to have a good predictive value. So consider that all other diseases, in other general diseases, most of the general disease has very low prevalence value. Very low prevalence, low predictive value. So if you go and do any test, unless we find a test which is 100% sensitive specific, any test just for the random screening, especially for the chronic disease, would be useless. And acute disease, because they are acute, by that before you do the test, the most of the infected disease epidemics would come, so screening is useless anyway. So in general, screening is not useful for most of the chronic diseases. Most of, I am not saying it is not useful for all the tests. There are certain things and we can discuss. It also depends upon the economics of the country. Small countries like Singapore, because they have a good economical situation, the population is very small, they can afford to do the screening. But our country, where we require resources to use for lots of other things, screenings become useless. Even with the high sensitivity and specificity of the test. Why negative predictive value is not much important as positive predictive value? What is the prevalence of glaucoma in population? Yesterday we had discussed, and I had said Kinney glaucoma study is open angle glaucoma 1.6%, 1% angle closure glaucoma, so is 2.6%. Let's round it up to 3%, 4%. So what is the chance, what is the normal population once you remove glaucoma? 96%. So before the test, 96% population is normal. So doing all these elaborate tests, from increase to 96% to 99% doesn't make much sense. So negative predictive value is not much important for screening. What we are interested is finding positive predictive value and high risk population. So simple thing, increase the prevalence of disease. So take the high risk group, then screen, then your positive predictive value increase. The chances of finding glaucoma also increase. need not do a general screening for the all the population. If I take from zero kids to 100 years, the prevalence from 3-4% will decrease to less than 2%. It would be nearly close to 1%. So the utility of the test and the money spent, not worth it. That is one aspect. We have discussed about negative predictive value. As I said, 97% you are sure before that patient doesn't have disease. You can only go to 99% or 99.8%, but that additional 2.8% for glaucoma is not worth it because money spent is much more. And we are not talking about all disease. Every individual disease you can decide based on this parameter whether it's worth doing screening or not. The general criteria, if the test is highly specific, don't look the sensitivity, look the specificity. If the specificity is 98%, more than 95%, and if the test is positive, then it literally rules in the disease. Because when you say 98% normal, it would detect normal. If the test is positive, then chances of being patient being normal is less than 2%. So very likely that patient has disease. And if the test is very sensitive, more than 95%, and if it is negative, then chances of patient having disease is very low, so it rules out the disease. So this is called spin and snout. Highly specific, negative, positive rules in the disease. Highly sensitive, negative, rules out the disease. These are the two things you must take from the sensitivity and specificity. Now let's go to the screening we have discussed. We are running little short, so let's skip this because I want to discuss the likelihood ratio. And as I said, sensitivity and specificity remains same, but based on prevalence, the predictive value changes. So using only sensitivity and specificity doesn't make sense. Second thing, when you use the sensitivity and specificity of one test, you are limiting to the one test. But if I do the glaucoma evaluation, I have examined clinically, I have checked intraocular pressure, I have checked done gonioscopy, I have done dilated optic disc evaluation, then I have done perimetry, then I may have done imaging test. So we have so many various tests. So how to incorporate value of results of each test and go to the final diagnosis? So we are using sensitivity specificity of each test step by step by using likelihood ratio. So likelihood ratio is of course incorporating sensitivity specificity of each test, but is incorporating all as a whole, and then we are reaching a final diagnosis. So we are not looking into each test only. I am not saying only OCT positive negative. I am saying what is a patient's clinical intraocular pressure, what is optic disc changes, and based on everything we build in and then go to the final diagnosis.
Rajul, just once again, let's confirm how much they have assimilated up to this point.
Sure.
Now, how many of you would say an extremely specific test, okay, is likely to be sensitive? Did you understand my question? If a test is extremely specific for a particular disease, okay, is likely to be less sensitive. You understand? A test which is extremely sensitive is likely to be less specific. Correct? So I look at the specificity and sensitivity like husband and wife. Okay? These two are individuals separate like this. As the sensitivity increases, the specificity comes down. See the graph. This comes down, this increases. There is a point where the two are happily married. That is the best possible specific and sensitive test, which is around 70%. If a test is around 70% to 75% specific, it is also likely to be some amount sensitive. So you need to look at a via media between these two things. What do you say, JP? What would be the same issue? Okay.
The other thing is using both is ROC curve.
Yeah.
But ROC curve would not be that useful in day-to-day practice.
Yes.
It's most, more for the manuscript.
Yeah.
Saying that the highest point where likelihood ratio will be able to use a sensitivity specificity of various tests.
Okay.
And reach to a final value that, you know, what are the chances that patient is actually having disease. And we are using, incorporating each step.
Okay.
And it's much more valuable. So ROC curve I have not put in my presentation because
okay.
I don't think, and I may be wrong, that for day-to-day practice ROC curve is useful. So I...
See, basically likelihood ratio is that what is the likelihood that a given test result would be expected in a patient with a target disorder compared to the likelihood that the same result would be expected in patient without the target disorder. Don't go for the definition. It's very straightforward thing. And at the end of the day, see that how we can use in day-to-day practice. Before I start, in routine practice, every patient do not require we have to follow all these thing. If for glaucoma, if the patient has 0.9 bipolar notch, pressure of 30, he is having straightforward glaucoma. Okay, based on his open angle or angle closure, we diagnose primary open angle glaucoma or primary angle closure glaucoma. If there is some secondary close, then you can diagnose pseudo exfoliation, etc., etc. For most of the disease, this stands true. These things is useful when you have a doubtful situations. When you are not very sure whether patient is normal or abnormal. Pressures are borderline, disc changes are borderline. In those cases, and we have a, in every specialty, there would be cases that they are borderline, you are not sure. Thus, these are the time these things will help you. Basically the same 2x2 table, positive likelihood ratio is sensitivity divided by 1 minus specificity. Now before we go, likelihood ratio is one aspect. Basically we want to go from pre-trace probability. What is your interest when the patient walks in? Your interest is that whether patient is having normal or what is the probability that patient is having specific disease. So let's say we are I am giving example purely glaucoma because much easier for me, but for any disease. So what is the pre-test probability? Because we go from pre-test probability to at the end of examination post-test probability. What is pre-test probability? Probability of the target disorder before a diagnostic test result is known. So basically it's very similar to the prevalence of disease. For most of the disease we know the prevalence. So what is the prevalence of glaucoma? Is approximately 1.5% before you examine the patient. A 45 year old patient walks in sitting in front of you in examination room. Without examination, 1.5% can have glaucoma out of 100. That's the prevalence of disease. Clear? From prevalence, so pre-test probability, you go to the pre-test odds. So pre-test probability divided 1 minus pre-test probability. So odds comes to 0.02. Pre-test odds, you multiply by target ratio, likelihood ratio, to get the post-test odds. Now these all again formula is not required. There are actually nomograms available where you can straightforward calculate the post-test probability based on likelihood ratio. And from likelihood ratio, post-test probability, you convert into post-test odds to post-test probability. So post-test probability is post-test odd divided by 1 plus post-test odd. So let's give one example. 45-year-old patient, family history negative, open angle, pressure 24, 0.7 Cupris ratio, inferiorum thinning, wedge shape defect, normal perimetry, and evident GDX score is 59. Now how will you proceed? First is pre-test probability. What is the pre-test probability? As I said, 1.5%. Now before that we should note some basic things, sensitivity, specificity of retest, because that is how we are going to use the likelihood ratio. And I have given you IOP 21, 50% sensitivity, 92% specificity. So in isolation, IOP is a useless test for the diagnosis of glaucoma because sensitivity specificity is very moderate.
optic disc is good, 80%, 95% specificity for the parameter I have written, 0.7 an inferior wedge shape defect. If it is 0.9 bipolar notch, then the sensitivity specificity would be different. GDX, from based on my data, sensitivity 53%, specificity 99%. So you just calculate likelihood ratio for it, 6.25, 16, 55. Now let's use step by step. So first, what you do in clinical practice? What is the first test we do? Intraocular pressure. So post test odds are, pre-test odds are 0.05. Then you multiply by IOP, likelihood ratio, 6.25. Post test probability is 0.24. That means if the pressure is more than 21, the chances of patient having glaucoma is 24%. Is it good enough for diagnosis? It is not good for the diagnosis, right? You would require at least around 85. If the value was 85%, I would have said that perimetry also is not required for diagnosis, but that is not the case. So now we built in IOP, and we go to the next thing. Is next step is optic disc evaluation. 16. So we have reached to 0.24 divided by 0.76 is 0.32. We converted to post-test sort and multiply with the likelihood ratio, and we got now final value of 0.84. So IOP more than 21, 0.7 cup with inferior thinning and wedge shape defect, RNFL defect. The post-test probability now increased from 1.5% to 84%. So your basic clinical examination has make you sure that 85% chance that patient is having glaucoma. Do we require any further test at this point in time? Because you were saying me that perimetry progression is required for the diagnosis. The question now is that at this point in time, do we require perimetry for the diagnosis? If you are around 85%, if you reach post-test probability, then I would say for glaucoma, and I think for most disease, we would not require any investigation for the confirmation. I will do perimetry. Of course, I will do perimetry for different reason. I will use the perimetry. I may do OCT also, but that is for the progression. Because glaucoma is a chronic disease, it is not a one-time event, we would require a test which would be a more observer independent. And my disc finding, your disc finding can vary. Unless we have taken disc photograph. So I will do perimetry for the subsequent test and subsequent follow-up, not for the diagnosis. Okay? Anyway, in this patient we have done OCT, GDX. So from 84, we reached 99.7% if the GDX was positive. But here I have not used GDX as isolation. I used all my clinical information, what was available to me. The basic things we do day in, day out for every patient. And then I will use the test because I wanted to be sure more than 95%. It need not be necessary, need not to be done all the patients. Now in one step, how we can do, you calculate all the likelihood ratio and you convert into post-test probability. So all the likelihood ratio with post-test odds, you will get directly post-test probability. Very simple thing, again there are nomogram available. So both, this is pre-test probability, likelihood ratio and post-test probability. You don't even have to calculate. You should know the likelihood ratio. Now good thing is that you don't have to calculate likelihood ratio also. Because now most of the journal, the good journal, they insist that when you report the about the diagnostic test, you must mention likelihood ratio. So most of the a good journal article, hopefully they would be better than other published in poor journal, would have the likelihood ratio also in place. Yeah, if you want to be more sure, you can calculate your own likelihood ratio based on your population, but you need not do you have a data available and you can simply do this. So this is positive likelihood ratio. The negative likelihood ratio basically is that what are the chances that patient is normal is exactly opposite. Again, personally, I don't think that, again, the importance of negative likelihood ratio for disease like chronic glaucoma is limited. But for completion, we will do is 1 minus sensitivity upon specificity. How much time we have? 1 minute. So, same, but exactly opposite, and we reach that if the test CDX was normal, patient chances of having normal, being normal is 99%. Since we are not running of time, running short of time, just example, this patient required the whole thing we did, step by step approach of calculating likelihood ratio, required, not required. There are, I think, few more ophthalmology residents I can see now. Friend, not required. This 21 normal perimetry, I think let's do it better. And that is what we can do. So in a doubtful situation, using basically the advantage of likelihood ratio that uses all the clinical information you have gathered and it puts in the perspective. So you are not doing that if the OCT is positive, negative, what are the chances? You are using the prevalence of the disease in that population. You are using all the basic information you have done. And then you go and say that what are the chances that patient has disease. And if the patient has disease, how I will proceed? That's the second question. But whether if you reach 85%, and this is I think last, this is the graph. If at the end of your clinical examination, if you think chance of patient having disease is less than 25%, please do not do any investigation, because from here you will reach on this gray area. And at the end of clinical examination, like IOP, optic disc for glaucoma, if you are more than 85% sure, you can start with the treatment. You do not require any other investigation for the confirmation of disease. The test is required, as I said, for different reasons. Now, every disease is different. When I talk about glaucoma, I am talking about glaucoma because I know about the disease. Now, some other disease, it may be different and you may do the investigation because the therapy can cause severe harm. So, in that cases, you may would like to confirm more than 85%, more than 95%, then you may require investigation. But bottom line is that if you are in the gray area for most of the chronic disease, the investigation would help because it will take you from here to more than 85%, from here to less than 25%, and will help you in deciding the management plan. Okay, thank you. Any question?
Thank you, Raju. Okay. That's very good. Very nice. Thank
any
you.
Any questions? And
anything to ask, Raju, to make your doubts clearer? I'll do the next thing. Then you can talk. No, he's finishing.
Oh, okay.
And as a continuation of the thought process, I'll do it.
No.
Sit down.
Sir, would you like to add something on likelihood ratio?
I know two things about this. What Rajul spoke about is an extremely important area in clinical practice and research. I also know the second part. It's also not easy to understand what he said. I want to, because I don't want to let go of that at this moment. Can I ask you a question? There are two ways for screening for breast cancer. Mass screening in the community. Test one has 90% sensitivity and 99% specificity. Did you hear it? Test one has 90% sensitivity and 99% specificity. Test 2 has 99% sensitivity and 90% specificity. Which test would you recommend to the government? Because it has got 99% sensitivity and 90% specificity. The answer is wrong. Okay, but don't feel embarrassed. That's what I want you to focus on, that one equation Raju showed for likelihood ratios. Go back and learn. It is sensitivity divided by specificity. 1 minus specificity or 100 minus specificity. In the first instance, it is 90 divided by 1 is equal to a likelihood ratio of 90. Do you remember what I said? 90% sensitivity and 99% specificity. Likelihood ratio is 90. In the second instance, it is 99% sensitivity and 90% specificity. The likelihood ratio is 9.9. The whole system is much weaker in the terms of predictive value. You will be frightening a large number of normal women saying you may have breast cancer while they don't. So this is an area, it took little, we are only 45 minutes to explain. I think he did a good job. But please pay attention. Think, very often science is counterintuitive. You think this is right, but the true science works the other way around.